We now return to Cannonball Run.
Last night, I got to witness Star Wars, The Rise of Skywalker in a half-empty theater. It wasn't until now that we came to fully realize just how much completely and utterly destroyed Star Wars. For 2 years, I was saying there was nowhere they could have gone after Episode 8. Kathleen Kennedy and Roundhead Rian Johnson not only subverted our expectations, they subverted the entire franchise. Roundhead destroyed every progress.
It has been a long time coming, and here we are at the end of the Skywalker Saga, it's being called. Saga, that word's being thrown around a lot. I am David Lawler. I am joined by John Fralick, of course, and David Anderson.
Hello, everybody.
David Anderson returns after being in the wilderness, and I guess he's going to go back into the wilderness after we're done, right?
You know what? I closed myself off from the Force, and much like Luke Skywalker, I was wrong, and I'll come back.
And you tossed the microphone over your shoulder.
Yes. I tossed the microphone over my shoulder. Yes. And I walked into the sunset, but I'm back. We're back.
And apparently,
I'm mad. Let's do this.
We're gonna just throw in a whole bunch of clips of everything because I had everything prepared, and I have a whole bunch of stuff that I was gonna throw in, and Anderson's gonna throw in stuff, and Fralick has a video of his immense collection, which I can't wait to look at. And
like the film itself, we're gonna just throw everything in and hope some of it makes sense.
Hope some of this shit sticks to the fucking wall.
Hope for the best, prepare for the worst. Well, the first thing I wanted to bring up, because again, we have this controversy that just seems to come out every so often. I remember controversy starting as early as, I want to say, well, once we get past Phantom Menace and Jar Jar Binks and all that stuff and the hatred for him, and then what Lucas did in the second movie, and then you see what J.J. Abrams does with Rose Tico in the third movie, it's a very much a Jar Jar treatment almost. It's actually worse. But that was the first bit of controversy was Phantom Menace. But then I remember there being a lot of controversy around Revenge of the Sith because of what appeared to have been Lucas's advocacy of fascism in some way. I remember hearing people talk about it on the train.
Advocacy?
Yeah, like a kind of advocacy. It's the thing that you and I talked about a while back when we were talking about how the resistance and the rebellion were not effective governments because they were too benevolent. So that
really
allowed criminals.
They were rebellions. They weren't.
But their New Republic. Let's
the
say
New
the
Republic.
New Republic.
Okay.
Yeah,
New
I was
Republic.
Gonna say, like, when the first part of the saga ends, it's all becomes after Jedi. It's all the New Republic.
It's all the New Republic. But then there was the Old Republic, and they didn't seem to be able to have an effective government because the criminals ran roughshod over everything. You had smugglers like Han Solo. You had anti-slavery laws being ignored. You know, things like that. But
well, see,
that was sort of the debate of Revenge of the Sith. Was
that's
that?
The problem with, and we have, you know, there is a balance between you have like liberal government. Do you want like, you know, personal freedoms, or do you want things to function?
Because do you want the trains? Do you want the trains to run on time?
You can't have both. I know, and it's unfortunate because even if like 90% of the people follow the rules, it's that always that 10 fucking percent that always fucks it up for everybody, and there's nothing we can do about it. It's just the way
those
it is.
That's why those 10% went to the Outer Rim to be in the planets that were not under the Empire's control.
At least far enough away so that the Empire could not exert its influence. But mm-hmm. then the Empire goes around and says, hey, we're the Empire, so...
Well, I mean, it's kind of like, you know, what have the Romans ever given us? World peace!
There seem to be... Okay, I've been poring over the internet.
Yes.
And looking at reviews and all kinds of stuff, there seem to be three distinct groups with differing opinions of The Rise of Skywalker. The first group is the fans of The Last Jedi didn't like it or enjoy it because it reverses much of that previous movie or ignores it completely. There's two, the haters of The Last Jedi who enjoyed The Rise of Skywalker for the same reasons. And then there's the third group, the people who enjoyed both movies. Now, I'm probably going to put myself in the second column because I despised Last Jedi. That movie, I told Freylich, I felt raped after I saw it. I felt raped. There were fresh marks on my butt. That's how I felt.
Didn't you say something to the effect of like your hate grew? Like, didn't your hate grow? Or is it about the same?
Well, yeah, but it didn't make me powerful. So I mean, like, it's not like what the Emperor.
And
Freylich,
you know, we never found out. What are your thoughts on The Last Jedi?
I didn't like it.
But
I guess
wait,
I'm in the minority.
I know you're the. Okay, I will.
Well,
say
didn't
that
you
tonight.
Didn't you have actually? I remember that you said you liked it a lot more before you saw Rise of Skywalker, but then you started to hate it more because of that, right? Is that what you said?
No, I've only seen Last Jedi twice. I saw it in the theaters, and it left such an unimpressive, you know, it was so unimpressive that I literally didn't watch it again for 2 years. Because, like Lawler said, there were so many things I hated about that movie. Number one, Rose Tico. I'm sorry, I didn't like her. She didn't meant to be there. Number two, the fucking casino planet, which was totally fucking pointless and drew me out of the movie. And it basically made Benicio del Toro's character fucking pointless. And he's a great actor,
yeah.
And they threw him away. My other third complaint, of course, you know, Luke throwing the fucking lightsaber over his shoulder. Everyone likes that part. I fucking hate that part.
I loved it.
I can't stand that part. I fucking hate it. And then, of course, you've got fucking Broom Boy.
Broom Boy.
Okay, you've got Broom Boy. It's like, oh, okay, so all of a sudden people are randomly force sensitive now, are we?
Well, does it
well,
not?
Yeah, because they did, but they... Look, they bring that up in this one. They bring up, like, the forces. There has been an awakening, you know? It's everywhere.
You know, they do that. They do that whole thing with frickin' Finn, where apparently he's force sensitive. That was his big secret that he wanted to tell Rey, was that, hey, Rey, I'm force sensitive.
Oh, really? Do you think that's what he was? I thought he was just gonna say, I love you.
J.J. Abrams said after the fact of the movie came out, of like, what was he gonna say? And he just sort of pulled that one out of his ass.
They sort of made it a running joke for a little while in the movie, but I thought it was just gonna be, I've always wanted to tell you I love you, because I was the guy. I was like, I guess the one guy in the room who shipped Finn and Rey, because I liked them as a couple and I thought they had really good chemistry. And then it's like JJ borrowed a little something from the Rian Johnson book of kicking people in the nuts with some kind of a weird kicker at the end, but we'll get to that when we get to that.
Kicking the nuts.
I swear to God. I mean, it was like, even Regan was watching and she put her head in her hands when she saw that final bit. And Bronwyn was like, I knew it. I've been shipping them because they have chemistry. And I was like, no, what are you doing?
I think that the original intent was he's going to try to say it and then never say it. And then you'll never know. And like,
what, that he loves her or that he has the Force? Because I mean, like, Finn
it
is
could
just...
could be anything. That's the point of, like, leaving it open.
Always, yeah, yeah. Like Lost in Translation when Bill Murray whispers into Scarlett Johansson's ear.
Exactly, something like that. It's like,
I mean, at the same time, though, you can't take away from the fact that Finn and Rose were supposed to be a couple.
Yes. I feel that they should have been. I mean, what happened at the end of Last Jedi? One thing in the Last Jedi that I did... Well, there were two things I liked. I liked Yoda. I liked seeing Yoda in Last Jedi. I thought it was wonderful. And the fact
that he was actually a puppet that time.
He was a puppet, and he was
also
like,
oh, well, hey, that's three things, actually. Well, the third thing might be part of just the new trilogy, the sequel trilogy, but I like the way they did the Force ghosts in this. Instead of having that blue outline that they had in the original movies, they kind of gave them more depth, more substance as ghosts in a certain way.
I look at it again. I saw it in, like, IMAX 3D, and it was in my face, so I had to see the subtleties later when I get the disc.
It made you feel that they were actually there, you know? I mean, and they were there. I know how they shot these things. They would put the actual person in the room with the person and then just create that blue outline.
Just remind me. I'll have some thoughts on Force ghosts that happen in this movie when we get to it, because I have some thoughts of, like, why didn't they do certain things? That's all I'm going to say.
Okay. Well, The Rise of Skywalker. Okay. It doesn't... Okay. Well, I was going to go into the things I liked about Last Jedi. One was Yoda.
Yeah.
The second one was the Force ghost effect, but they kind of do a little bit of that in the first movie, too. Or do they? Do they have a Force ghost in
No, there's
Force
no.
They do
there's
not.
No.
Oh, okay. Okay, that's right.
They do not have it in A New Hope.
No. Okay, so it is actually part of Last Jedi, so credit to whoever, Rian Johnson maybe. And then the third thing was Finn and Rey hugging at the end when they, cuz the Last Jedi, again, I sort of saw it as a series of missed opportunities once you realize what's happening in The Rise of Jedi. One of the most important things was we have to get these kids together and have them have an adventure. And I felt like Last Jedi split them up before they could be together. So they're kind of pre-existing on some kind of chemistry that they really didn't have yet. Unless we're to assume that Rise of Jedi occurs much later in the future after. Or I'm sorry, Rise of Skywalker occurs much later in the future.
I think just a little bit, like a year or something. It's not
Yeah,
like
they said it was like a year. It was like a year after Last Jedi.
Okay, you know, so let's assume, I guess, maybe we have another TV show in there.
Or... Because you got to remember, Rose got hurt at the end of Last Jedi, and we, you know, we're kind of left questioning her fate, but we can see in Rise of Skywalker.
We're kind of hoping for her demise, you know.
Why and we don't know. We don't know how long. We don't even know how long Kylo Ren's been the Supreme Leader. They don't even say.
Kylo Ren, Supreme Leader, and then we have Admiral. Admiral Hux. That's another thing we got to talk about. Okay, so it doesn't really continue the storyline. There's only one through element from Last Jedi that continues into Rise of Skywalker, and it was something that I thought Rian Johnson was going to take advantage of in Last Jedi, and that was the submerged X-wing fighter. I thought that he was going to use that in some form. But then Luke comes out, you know, pulls the Yoda thing. Oh, that was wonderful. That was a wonderful scene. I love to see that X-Wing come out of the water. It was wonderful.
Yeah, I did enjoy the fact that, like, I always like it when they plant a seed and then it's used way later.
But that was really late, though. I thought it was a Chekhov's gun. I thought it was going to be introduced in the first act and then go off in the third.
See, let's put this way. This is how much I didn't like Last Jedi. I totally forgot about that X-Wing even being shown in The Last Jedi.
I remembered it. I saw it. It was there. And I was like...
I remember that. And I'm like, oh, but the way
they
made it
in that
movie was...
Okay, this is the problem with Rian Johnson. He's too busy trying to have a deeper meaning to everything. His X-Wing fighter, I think, was some kind of a visual metaphor for Luke. Like, Luke has given up so much that he
completely cut himself off. He put his ship, he crashed his ship. He doesn't care. He wants to just stay away.
But that's not Star Wars. I mean, it might be admirable. It's like, Last Jedi could have been a really good movie if it had not been Star Wars. I think that might... That, except for some of the jumbled bits, the hour in the middle.
The reasons you hate it, reasons a lot of people hate it is the reason I love it, because again, it has to do with, if you're going to do a new trilogy, you gotta basically say, okay, we're doing something different, and we're taking it in a different direction because we bought this property, and we're going to do something different. We're not going to just rehash the same thing.
If you're going to do that, why not do that with the first movie? Just give us some kind of a warning.
J.J. Abrams, he said, that was intentional.
Because Force Awakens is basically a better-made version of A New Hope. Because
he needed to start over. He's like, okay, I got to get these new characters established. I'm going to do sort of a reboot. Now, if there had been some sort of interesting things with Palpatine where he said, like, the same patterns are repeating over and over again because I have willed it or something like that. If he could have just explained it, but not whole tons of things are not explained.
Palpatine is kind of, it's of the revelations of Rise of Skywalker, Palpatine is probably the weakest for me because he really does nothing. He's sitting in the old, it's possible, I suppose, and if they can make Leia fucking fly in space, they can, I guess, keep Palpatine alive.
Well, isn't, like, the new meme is, like, you know, somehow Palpatine is alive or something like that. And it's,
well,
like,
I figured there's no
dark magic. Dark magic, the Force.
you're supposed to believe that he survived the crash landing of the new Death Star on one of the moons of Endor.
Let's assume that he felt he was thrown down the shaft by Vader. And as he was plummeting, the ship, the space station explodes, and some bottom chunk of the Death Star soft landed in the atmosphere of Endor, the forest moon, and he's there.
There. He's not. But he's not there. He's on that evil, the Exegol. He's on the evil
Exegol.
He's not there.
But then you know his followers. But because he still had followers when it was all over. They could have freaking picked him up, resuscitated him or whatever, and then carried him off to Exegol. And you got to remember, Exegol's never been mentioned in any of the other movies prior because it was the hidden Sith world that we just now find out about in Rise of Skywalker.
There's a lot of things kind of fly together here.
It starts off, I mean, we went, like, are we going to sort of go through the actual movie, like, sort of scene by scene and tear it apart?
No,
I don't want to tear this damn thing apart.
No mention is made of him in The Last Jedi, but his presence is announced in the opening crawl. And I want to know, my last bit for you before we get into our top 10 lists is that Rian Johnson had been initially offered his own 3-movie deal with Lucasfilm to do a new trilogy in that very short honeymoon period after Last Jedi was completed. Instead, he went and made Knives Out. I don't think he's going to be invited back. What do you think? Theories?
No, he gone.
And he gone. Fine. You know what? He made... As far as I'm concerned, he made an excellent Star Wars movie. Now he's doing his own thing, which is what he was doing before Star Wars. He's going to be fine. Knives Out is like this huge sleeper hit now. And everybody's going to be okay except for Kathleen Kennedy. I think she's the one who's going to get the axe for
everything. Really? You think? But the movie is making... I mean, there was a very brief period there where it looked like it was going to go the Solo route, but now it's making money. And now it's seriously making money because people...
It's making money, but it's gonna make the least of all the 3 new ones.
You think? I think it might make more than Last Jedi.
It's making... Here's the thing. Last Jedi...
What are we at right now? 835?
Like 950-some... Last Jedi made like 620 some. This is going to make, it's going to make like Rogue One level money, maybe a little more, maybe like 530, 550.
It's already done 720.
Worldwide. I'm talking
worldwide.
Like
no, worldwide. US. No, worldwide, we're over 835.
Worldwide, it might crack like 1.1, 1.2 billion, maybe. But like the Last
that's
Jedi
still
made
ahead. 1.3. That's how, but that's still ahead. If it can make over, if it doesn't do Solo business, it's a hit.
Oh, so that's already been way more than Solo. But see,
yeah. I honestly don't think they're going to fire Kathleen Kennedy because here's the thing. Each of these new Star Wars movies has cracked a billion. Okay. She has made them money. And of course, you've now got The Mandalorian. Okay. Which is fucking awesome. Mandalorian.
I think she's probably hands off because, like, she put Favreau in charge of that and said, you just go do that. Like, I wonder, like, how much she's in charge. Like, this is. She's negotiating. It's like this weird thing where it's like Disney has ideas, she has ideas, the directors have ideas. This isn't a cohesive form of what they're trying to do. This isn't like, I've kind of like thought about this. It's kind of like the James Bond movies. James Bond movies.
Just adding some music.
Mm-hmm. It's the Broccoli Family. Okay, Broccoli Family, and then they use United Artists MGM money, which is never around, and then sometimes through Sony. And then Sony. I mean, there were Sony leaks about what they should do. And because like the last movie Spectre should have been the best James Bond movie ever because they had Spectre back, they had Blofeld back, they had everything back. It was okay, but Star Wars is like James Bond now, where it's like some are going to be okay, some are going to be but they're always going to have a minimum level of quality, and some are going to make more, some are going to make less.
But you got to remember, Kennedy didn't lay out that blueprint. It was Lucas who laid out that blueprint of where some of them are going to be okay, some of them are going to be really good.
Yeah.
Because then, you go back to the prequel trilogy because we all agree that Revenge of the Sith is better than frickin' 1 and 2.
It is, but I'll tell you, man, when I, because I watched
well,
all
do
the
I?
Movies.
Let me check my list. It narrowly edges out Phantom Menace, yes.
I watched all of the movies in preparation, okay? Now, I went in, I actually watched Phantom Menace on Laserdisc first, of course, and I'm like, okay.
Did you finally spot the beauty marks on Carrie Fisher?
I'm having sort of a Star Trek Generations moment where I'm like, you know, this kind of sucks, but I'm entertained. It's fun. I'm not pissed, you know.
All right. Let's do our top 10 list.
Okay.
I'm gonna start her off. Of course, now we know what number one is because number one is number one on everyone's list always.
Yes.
Empire Strikes Back. Empire Strikes Back from 1980. Followed
except for that one guy. Except for that one guy that is like having an argument with Siskel and Ebert. I'll send you the clip. Where he's like this intellectual, up his own ass.
I saw that. He's a fucking jackhole.
All right. We'll cue the clip and I'll throw it in.
I think the raves for the early Star Wars have been so violent and so extravagant that I feel one cannot afford to mince one's words if one dislikes these things.
You certainly did not do that. But why do you feel they are so bad?
I feel they're so bad because they're completely dehumanizing. Obviously, let's face it, they are for children or for childish adults. They're not for adult mentalities, which unfortunately means that they're not for a lot of my fellow critics who also lack adult mentalities. But anyway, they are for children, and they're brutalizing children. They're stultifying children. They're making children dumber than they need to be.
Surprisingly enough, he gave Hollywood Nights 4 stars.
Okay, so now the way I rate it, wow. Okay, let's. Man, I lost my train of thought when you said
that. Sorry, you were talking. Empire Strikes Back is the best.
Right. Okay, so I rated these on a scale of 10 each movie in addition to my list. So. Number one, Empire Strikes Back. It's a 10 out of 10 for me. I consider it a perfect movie. Number two, Force Awakens, 8 out of 10. Okay? Notice there's no 9 out of 10. Force Awakens, because I consider it a superior version of Star. It's basically A New Hope remade, but it's remade with a certain level of confidence, I guess, that Lucas maybe didn't have in 77. Number three, Star Wars, A New Hope, of course, 7 out of 10.
Whoa!
I give it that. Because, yes, it is the beginning, and it is a superior film, but Lucas has a hard time directing actors, and the actors had to do a lot of the heavy lifting when it came to, you know, creating their characters.
Remember to put it in historical context just because of it. When it came out, that was a thing.
Yeah.
That was mind-blowing to people that saw it, because this is 1977.
Oh, yeah. The phenomenon, obviously. But
yeah,
guys,
remember one thing. Don't sell yourself short. Just remember, Star Wars was saved in the editing room, okay?
Yeah, it was.
It was.
Lucas is responsible for creating, but he had very little hope for the movie. He thought it would make its money back, it would be profitable, and he'd be able to sell a coffee mug. That's what I remember.
For him, it wasn't kind of like an out of control Disney movie. It's like he was trying to just make a kids movie, and then the budget blew up, and the whole thing. He's like, oh shit, this needs to make money.
All right, now we're gonna get into the change, and you guys are gonna roll your eyes. Number four, with a 6 out of 10, Rogue One. I love Rogue One. I hated it when I first saw it.
Six out of 10 ain't great.
I hated what they did to my beloved Carrie at the end, even though they got the beauty mark just right. Mm-hmm. But it gets a 6 out because it's a very different Star Wars. This is what you were talking. You know how you said, well, they went another direction with Last Jedi. I felt like they went another direction with Rogue One. It was very much kind of like I don't know. It was like Inglourious Bastards, Dirty Dozen Star Wars style. That's what it reminded me of. Okay, number five, another 6 out of 10. Rise of Skywalker. that it gets a number solid five. I told you guys, I told the both of you, solid five. So
I can agree to that.
It gets a 6 out of 10 for me. Now, right just under that at 5 out of 10, Solo. I really love Solo. I love the way it was made. It was a mess, of course. They fired directors to different tone changes. But Ron Howard is always a very competent force, and he's one of the few directors that you actually, that we all actually know his work. Now, number 7, we're getting into the 4 out of 10. Revenge of the Sith is my favorite of the prequel trilogy, and then that's followed by Phantom Menace. Phantom Menace, mainly for that kind of nostalgia sentiment, and there's a lot of stuff in there that I find really exciting, like, of course, the Duel of the Fates. I love Liam Neeson, Ewan McGregor. They're great. The kid is annoying, but, you know, and he says yippee, I think. And then after that, at number 9, we have The Last Jedi. Now, The Last Jedi is the best movie of the bottom three for me, because I felt like somebody put some thought into it, unlike the final two movies, which are, in order, Return of the Jedi and Attack of the Clones. That's my
Return
list.
Return of the Jedi, jeez.
Return of the Jedi gets number 10, Attack of the Clones is number 11.
Dude, Anderson, he's the Dante Hicks, man. He says all Jedi had was a bunch of fucking Muppets.
I put Jedi ahead of Clones because it's part of the original trilogy, yes, but it gets a 2 out of 10, and it shares that with Last Jedi for me anyway, but I felt that Last Jedi was marginally better than Return of the Jedi because a little more thought was put. I mean, I can hate Rian Johnson all I want. I can hate him till the cows come home, but he put a lot of thought into it, more thought than it probably deserved.
Your hate only makes him stronger.
And Attack of the Clones, we all agree, probably the worst one. Do we all agree on that?
I agree
on that. It's the worst one. So who's next on their personals? Are we doing personals?
I'll let you go first, and then I'll do the final, because I'll probably get the most flack for it.
You'll get the most heat. Okay.
Here we go.
All right. So, of course, number 1, Empire Strikes Back. That's without a doubt. Number 2, Star Wars A New Hope. I don't do number ratings. I just go on my likes and dislikes. All number right. 3, Force Awakens, only because, like Lawler said, I don't think it was a better remade version of Star Wars, but I think it was, like, a great remake of Star Wars.
It was interesting. Where, You switched it.
Yeah, where it needed to be, because it was so enjoyable. Number 4, here's where we get divisive. Revenge of the Sith.
What?
Yes.
I'm sorry.
You know what?
John, you ignorant slut.
Hey, you know what? I fucking love Revenge of the Sith, okay?
No, that's fine. I, you know what? Revenge of the Sith is awesome because it has... That final 20 minutes of the movie is brilliant. That's exactly what I wanted to see.
You know, my thoughts on it is all the pieces were there, much like with this movie. All the pieces were there. They just weren't put together exactly right because it was George Lucas trying to fit the rest of the pieces in and get all the stuff in there. And I felt like it just doesn't quite get there. Now, it does not suck, and I am not mad. And it gave you what you wanted, but, you know, there was no like, flair to it. There was no...
It's like,
we're going to give you what you want here.
In those final 20 minutes, it is Lucas remaking The Godfather, because you have the baptism of Michael Corleone and then the death of all his enemies to assure his place, his power in the mafia. In Revenge of the Sith, you have the death of Anakin Skywalker, the birth of Darth Vader, and the birth of Luke and Leia, and it's all sort of put together beautifully. It was exactly the way I thought it should go.
Except the way Amidala died, that was kind
of
dumb.
But, Amidala died of a broken heart.
Yeah, it was kind
of
dumb.
Well, whatever.
I'll even say that was kind of dumb. That was Lucas painting himself into a corner.
But they did that. But this happens in Rise of Skywalker. There's like, I know there's good in him. So I'm going to do something incredibly stupid, you know, and it's going to wind up killing a bunch of people or something.
Well, anyway, back to it. Number 5, Return of the Jedi.
Oh, what the fuck, really? What are you doing to me? The fuck? You put Jedi at... What the fuck is... Oh. Okay, explain yourself, young man.
I'm allowed to put Jedi at number 5, thank you very much.
Explain yourself.
The first hour, that's all I need to explain.
Okay.
Job of the Hutt.
Yeah.
But we postulated... I remember postulating this with Anderson, that the first act of Return of the Jedi is really just the last act of Empire Strikes Back. Jedi begins with Ewoks. That's my theory anyway.
Okay, remember where you try to say I'm this like mature guy and all this other stuff? Here's where the age comes into play. I was that kid who liked fucking Muppets, okay?
We grew up with the Muppets.
I would hug, might as well just spoil a little bit of it. At the end of Rise of Skywalker, JJ gives us Ewoks, and it was nice to see. I liked seeing the Ewoks. It kind of brought it full circle. It acknowledges the Ewoks.
It was Wicket the Ewok, and I'm like, he didn't look like Wicket the Ewok to me. Maybe he looked older.
It was 30 years later.
I guess. That's probably, his kid, too? You think that's...
And his kid, or yeah.
Kid or his wife, whatever. They don't even say.
But it was wonderful to see them because it was acknowledgement of the Ewoks. Even though it's kind of, we look at it embarrassing today, and even Lucasfilm kind of looks on it not quite Star Wars Holiday Special embarrassment.
Try not to rip it open, because it makes a very handy storage case for your tools until you need them again.
Pardon me, just going to have a stroke here, and okay, there, where were we?
Now, this is the first thing you'll need.
Insert it into your...
Yourself on the sharp edges.
We now pause for a brief moment for Satan to possess him entirely.
Did David Lynch guest direct this segment, or?
Return of the Jedi. I clocked it and I timed it when I actually watched Return of the Jedi. From when they meet the Ewoks, I guess maybe from when Carrie Fisher meets the Ewoks and then they get taken to like when they get in that thing and get in the trap and then they meet the Ewoks until they actually like, you know, when Luke gives himself up and then the battle starts. It's literally only maybe like 10 minutes of the actual movie where it slows down. And the movie itself is like 2 hours and, well, the extended, it's like 2 hours 17.
So I would say...
Really, it's not that much of the movie. And
well,
then
I would say then that Jedi then begins instead. Let's say Jedi begins with the new mission, which is a second Death Star. And Mon Mothma and all that.
That's my thought. But hey, look, tenure...
I mean, it's like, it's they didn't... I feel like they didn't have a story, so they just said, okay, second Death Star.
11-year-old me thought that the half-built Death Star thing was like the coolest idea ever.
It was, but you shouldn't.
I'm making circles.
But this is wrong, though. This doesn't feel like the Galactic Empire. This feels like counting your chickens before they're hatched or something.
Well, remember, he's the Emperor. It's the whole thing where it's
like counting your eggs
to get them, you know. The whole idea was to get them there. Every time he tries to build some sort of big scary thing to destroy people with, all of his enemies get together and try and destroy it, and then he can destroy them. It's actually a good plan.
But it's like a weird, why, I don't understand. He's got this death fetish too. He's like, strike me down, come on, strike me down, you have to kill me, you kill me and then you become evil.
Okay,
he does that twice.
Finish his list here,
go ahead. Sorry, I'm lost on Jedi now.
It's fine. I enjoy you guys doing this. Number six, Rise of Skywalker.
Very close to mine.
It gets a number six for me because...
Wow,
you know,
I liked it better.
At the end of the day, I enjoyed it. And two words for you, Babu Frick.
Babu Frick, my favorite character ever. I love him. Hello, Babu Frick. I kept saying that to Regan. Nick, I was whispering it in her ear when we were watching. I was going, hello, Babu Frick. I love that guy. I love him. And he's like, and then C-3PO, it's like a joke. They set it up like a joke, and then it gets a payoff. C-3PO says, Babu Frick, he's my oldest friend, after they erased his memory. And I was like, well, that was fucking awesome. I love, also, I got to say, love that they incorporated C-3PO more into the action. I feel like he has, like, for the first time in 9 movies, he has a personality. It's, like, strange. I mean, it's like, he was like this uptight, fussy robot in the 6 movies, and then... Here he's got like an identity, and he's there's a bit where he's like looking at everybody. He's like, I just want to look at you all before you wipe my memory, because I want to remember my friend. And I'm like, this is C-3PO, dude. He's like,
it would have made more sense if he'd said that to the original cast instead of these new people that he
met. But again, missed opportunities there, because Force Awakens, the one thing I didn't like about Force Awakens is that we didn't get to see Han, Luke, and Leia together again in one last adventure. Instead, they were all scattered apart. You know, that's another thing that
we got them all in a weird way in this one, you know, but we got to let Freylich finish his list here.
Finish your list. All right.
All right. So after that, we got Solo, which which I've already said the best way I can sum it up, it was the Star Wars movie we didn't ask for, but it was the one we needed the most at the time after the shitstorm that was The Last Jedi.
I'm sensing a pattern here. I'm not hearing Rogue One at all in this list.
Oh, well, that's next.
Okay.
Rogue One is next. The only reason Rogue One gets lumped lower, I'm not a fan of espionage movies. I get that it's like a Dirty Dozen, Ocean's 11 type movie, but I'm not a fan of those movies.
Inglorious Rebel Bastards.
Well, it's also not a very good plan. It's not done very well either.
Yeah, it's just like, I mean, the only thing that was awesome about it was, outside of your whole, you know, Carrie Fisher thing, I did love the end. The end was great. It was just, it was,
I don't
just
understand how they nailed the Peter Cushing, but
the
they didn't
10
nail
minutes
Peter.
Of that movie. It's full. It's like Star Wars porn, you know. It's the great. I mean, I get a little verklempt every time,
because it's
so perfectly Star Wars, but that's only 10 minutes of the movie.
Right.
Are you talking about the final 10 minutes, right?
When Darth Vader comes out, although it's completely inconsistent with his character, where, you know, he's full. He's in full Jedi mode. He's like doing the things that you were hoping he'd do in
he's
something.
He's throwing people around and
he's
all
moving people around. And then as soon as, you know, it goes right into the original Star Wars, and then he's there and he's just sort of some lumbering stuntman walking around trying to look imposing. It doesn't quite fit, but
well, maybe okay. I can maybe explain or bullshit my way out of this one, but maybe he was just so fucking angry in A New Hope that Princess Leia got away from him with the plans or something, and the plans are gone, that he doesn't want to use his force powers. He just wants to choke the life out of somebody. That's what I was thinking.
Yeah, man, I don't know. But he doesn't even use his force powers. He grabs that dude and picks him up. He crushes him with his hand.
He just wanted, sometimes you just want to pick up like a bat and beat the shit out of somebody, even if you have a shotgun.
Well, because you also got to remember, when the first Star Wars movie premiered, you know, no one knew about the Force yet, and we didn't know about Vader and, you know, his whole thing with the Force and everything like that. So they, you know, you can't give too much away too quick.
Although commendable to Rogue One that they kind of went back to the original Darth Vader mask design, where it's always been slightly altered through the years, and it's much more A New Hope looking helmet. It has changed. I looked at, like, I saw a comparison.
It's
of
a
the
little,
helmets.
Yeah, it looks maybe a little dirty, a little scuffed, but then it's nice and polished in Empire and Jedi. Okay,
right,
next.
So after Rogue One, The Phantom Menace.
Phantom Menace. Where are we? I don't even know where we are.
Well, we're on number 9 right there. That's
number 9. Oh, okay. So you put it so lower. All right.
Yep, number 9 is Phantom Menace. In spite of its problems, I still do enjoy the movie. Once you get past the talk of trade federations, once you get past Jake Lloyd as his stupid performance as Anakin Skywalker, you know, never since the kid who played Damien in The Omen ever wanted to punch a little motherfucker in the face so bad. but anyway, I digress.
Yahoo!
I don't hate Jar Jar like everybody does. I think Jar Jar was funny as hell, even though a lot of people thought he was annoying. I love Jar Jar, but it is what it is.
You know what?
It
he
is
didn't.
What it is.
He annoyed like a lot of people, and a lot of people complained. I wasn't like angrily annoyed by Jar Jar. I just thought he seemed out of place. That's all. He seemed out of place.
A little bit, because the Star Wars movies never really have that kind. I mean, this was trying to be the new 3DO. I get what Lucas is trying to do. It's like, oh, we need a 3DO type character, you know, for these Jedi to follow around, you know. So that's where they came up with Jar Jar. But they went.
That's
like
where they came up with Rose.
Yeah, they went super over the fucking top.
That guy that played Jar Jar, like, this was right at the kind of the beginnings of the internet. But like this was what the internet was made for this poor actor to get hassled. And he, like,
well,
he went through a lot of emotional turmoil because he was hassled a lot.
Yeah, but the thing, I have so many issues with that. Everybody, like, the same thing happened with Kelly Marie Tran. And what actors need to realize is nobody hates you. They just hate the part you're playing.
And in her case, her performance as Rose was terrible. Honestly, I don't know if it had to do with the fact of her character just being there for Finn, or the fact is that she can't act.
I know. Well, no. She can't act. I didn't have a problem with her performance. She's such a sumptuous target to hate. She's so perfect to take all your hatred, put it in a bag, and just throw it at her, because I didn't like what I felt. I wrote an article about it for Second Union. I wrote how Rose is basically everyone's chubby, ugly sister who eventually becomes a beauty queen. It's like she's all that Star Wars style. Take off the glasses, you're a beautiful, sexy young woman. But it really didn't work for me, because I felt like what she was doing was empowering all of the ugly ducklings out there. Like, we, like Kathleen Kennedy was like, you know, nobody thought I was attractive. We're going to put an unattractive one. We're going to actually, Kelly Mary Tran is an attractive woman. They made her look unattractive in that movie. I've seen pictures of her. She's not a bad looking broad.
Well, then she did the, what is it? The press junket on Kimmel for Rise of Skywalker. And I was just like, wow, that's you. I was like, holy crap, you're hot.
I mean, I feel like they wanted her to be chubby. They wanted her to be unattractive and get the boy. And you notice in Rise of Skywalker, they barely say boo to one another. I feel like something didn't work, you know?
Well, she got cut out because they said that there was a lot of scenes that she had with the sort of the half-done Carrie Fisher stuff, and it just didn't quite work, so they had to just cut her out. I don't know if that's true, but that's what they're...
I don't know. Studios lie, man. And actors lie, too. I mean, fucking Marina Sirtis and Jonathan Frakes said they were not invited to work on Picard, and here they are. So... people lie. Get, that's all they do.
Let's get down to scraping the bottom of the barrel. Of course, number 10 is Last Jedi. And we've already talked about it. We've dragged it through the mud enough. We won't need to drag it through the mud anymore. We all know that the dead on arrival is Attack of the Clones.
Yes,
that's just one of them. That's, you know,
Hayden
what?
Christensen saying, "I hate them, I hate them."
I feel bad for him because he is a really good actor. Shattered Glass, and then Come Back.
Life is a house.
You know, he is. That's why.
I'm sure he's a fine actor, but you know,
he's a good actor. But they just, you know, it's George Lucas's direction. I'm
George
like,
Lucas. He said, "I want you to be
just
angry.
Do it. Just, you know,
Hayden, like, I want you to be angry. Just be angry."
You know, and he was a young guy at the time. He's like, he probably didn't understand, like,
okay,
to,
in
to,
what
like,
world
when a director is being shitty? You
in what
bring
weird
it.
Kind of time travel related theory of relativity bullshit is Anakin 10 years younger than Natalie Portman in one movie, and then the same age as her in the other two? It's like,
well,
the weirdest fucking
are
thing.
Are we meant to believe that Natalie Portman does not age? Or say, like you just said, Queen Amidala does not age?
Oh, yeah. She's an elected queen.
Natalie Portman still looks pretty much, she's kind of small anyway. So she kind of looks, I mean, you could say in Phantom Menace she's like 14, and then the next one she's 24. You know?
Yeah, well, that's going by the Weird Al song, though.
The Weird Al. Oh, my God.
That's going by the Weird Al song, even though he's just 9 and she's 14.
Do you see him hitting on the queen? Oh, he's just 9 and she's 14. Yeah, he's probably gonna marry her someday.
All right, now we're on to
Mr. Anderson.
Who
okay,
is going
I'm
to
gonna go full Matrix Revolutions on you now. Okay.
Oh, God, please don't.
Wait, no. As long as there's no orgy, I don't mind.
So,
I am Neo.
First movie, Empire, obviously. Second, I'm just going to breeze through that. Two is A New Hope, not just for the fact that it's accident, as we were talking about before, like it's accidentally a good movie because it was fixed in editing, but also the cultural impact in my childhood and the toys and everything.
That's
what that is. Number three is Last Jedi.
David, you ignorant slut.
Why?
Here's what. Why?
You called... Okay, can I just say something? David, you called me once Loki, the god of mischief. You are the god of mischief.
And I'm god of thunder, too.
And rock and roll.
Depending on what I eat. Okay, so I... Okay, here's the thing. It takes... It deconstructs Star Wars, and I like that. Because at this point, maybe in the series, in my life, I don't know, but it was time to take that chunk of my childhood and put it in its place and do something different. And I thought that this movie was, it surprised me. It challenged me on certain things that I was completely open-minded about. Cause like, this is coming after Force Awakens, where it's like, oh, well, this is okay. What I liked about it was I really like these characters. There's a sense of fun. It's, you know, it's exciting. There's spaceships. It's great. But it felt very conventional to me, and it also had things that I expected to happen that did happen, where it's like they're gonna probably kill off Han Solo, and they killed off Han Solo, and I'm like, okay, they did what I thought that they would do. But then this comes along, I'm like, you start off and it's like he flings the lightsaber, I'm like, oh fuck, and then he doesn't want to do anything, he doesn't want to go anywhere, and then you have the whole thing with Snoke, and he's doing his thing and he's trying to get Kylo Ren, and he's being mean to him now, he's saying, you know, all this old Star Wars shit that you're into, it's wrong. And then you have
Snoke.
And maybe you're not the chosen one.
What was the point of Snoke? I had to say.
Well, we get to that in Rise of Skywalker. There was no point, and that's one of the things I actually liked. I kind of
wait.
Cheered.
Okay. Before you continue.
Yes.
Do you remember the scene in Revenge of the Sith where the Emperor makes the special order to kill all the Jedi?
Yes.
And then we cut to Yoda, and Yoda clutches his heart, and he looks down. That's what I'm feeling right now listening to you. Just so you know. Oh.
I'm doing like a Princess Leia when she feels hand die.
When she feels hand die. Oh.
Okay, so, and then we have the ending with Snoke where it's like, I was legitimately surprised. In that sort of that battle when he sliced Snoke in half, I'm like, okay, this is going off in the area. I don't know where the fuck this is going.
I forgot there was one other element of Last Jedi I did like. I did like the fact that the entire resistance had been wiped out and you could fit all of them into the Millennium Falcon and they all escape. That I liked, but again, it's too brave a movie to do at that point, I think. If you're going to do brave, maybe start at the beginning, not in the middle. I feel like that was it. But go ahead.
I think the reason I like this so much is it's very much like Empire Strikes Back, where it's like they take something that's established of what you think Star Wars is when you see the original Star Wars, and you have an audience, especially that one guy that just hates Star Wars in general, where people... I'm turning to that kid again. Like, did you ever have a dream where the thing... okay. you know what I'm talking about.
Have you ever had a dream that you want him to do you so much you could do anything?
So I'm very excited now. I'm getting all nerdy. So you have the Star Wars. Like, the original Star Wars is one way. It's like this throwback to these sort of almost like Flash Gordon-y things. But then you get an Empire Strikes Back, and it's like, oh! Because he had snuck in a little bit of the mysticism with, like, the Force and everything, but it was so vague. And then you have Empire Strikes Back, where first you have, like, Obi-Wan Kenobi shows up as a Force ghost. You've never seen that before, you know?
Yeah.
He shows up in a vision, and it's like, oh, okay, there's Force ghosts. It's kind of like these invented powers. Where, like, so when people get mad about, like, Superman 2, where it's like, he has all these invented powers. Like,
it was something that was previously, it was never explained.
This is a comic book, you know? This is a space movie.
All we had known of before was that Obi-Wan could have a disembodied voice at the end of the New Hope.
They're making it up as they go along, and that's fine. It's like, oh, the Force can do this. Oh, the Force can do that.
So, you know, maybe you just have to believe in yourself more, you know, because you have... But it's Kasdan who's writing this with Lee Brackett. They took turns writing this script.
Well, okay, I'm gonna challenge you. The story I heard was she wrote the script, she then died.
He punched it up.
Kasdan was brought in, and most of the story elements from that version, maybe like a couple ideas, but most of it was just him completely rewriting it.
Well, I mean, Kasdan was probably just based on his work. I would say he was probably in charge of maybe strengthening some relationship ties and adding a little more pomp and action to it.
Okay.
Whereas Leigh Brackett was more kind of Western and ambush and big ass fucking AT-ATs or shit.
Like, remember, we could have gotten that weird sort of cheap sequel where it's like all on one planet. And it's.
It was handled so well. I mean, it was like handled so well because Irving Kirshner was a complete pro, and he handled his act. And also, it's the actors so strong in that movie.
That's what I liked about this movie was they did something different at the expense of whatever.
At the expense of, yes, like I said, it's brave.
It was a brave move. Now, I thought, you know, you pick it apart. It's like, I thought it was incredibly well made, except for the, like, even the can't, like, you have to remember, this is just a kid's movie.
Everybody says that you have that little side journey
where they go. And I'd like to sort of also say, you know, people are saying, oh, they're against rich people. No, they're actually the people that are on that planet, the rich fuckers that are on that planet. They're rich fuckers because they're like arms dealers.
Yeah. But
it's like a place for arms dealers to go spend their money.
Well, I mean, but the thing is, the resistance needs arms too. You know, I mean, you can't bankroll.
Exactly. But it's that, like, they're selling to both sides.
What I had said in my Last Jedi, my article about Rose Tico, is you can't bankroll a resistance with poor people. Leia and Amidala were supporters of resistance, and they were wealthy. So obviously you need wealthy people.
Well, also, I mean, who's to say that, I mean, there was some sort of final
battle.
Remember,
she's rich.
There was like a final battle on Jakku where, Jakku. You know, that's where all the stuff was like, you know, there's why there's all that sort of that stuff, you know, all that the broken ships and everything. It looked like mostly Empire stuff, like because they obviously lost. My opinion on that movie is it's an interesting sort of side. I'm like, oh, okay, this is going to take it into another area. And I guess it did, but it's not an area I would, I mean, again, so I'll get to the next one. The next one is
number four. This would be number four, right?
No, this would be number three. Well, you're in number four. You're right. Okay. Two, three, four would be Return of the Jedi.
Thank you.
I'll put Return of the Jedi, and here's why. This is why. It's the finishing of the original trilogy. Again, it's my childhood, okay? A lot of it works. If you really go back, people poo-poo it all the time, I mean, Ewoks and everything. But when you look at it, it is somewhat of a clunky wrap-up, but it gives you what you want, but it doesn't take any risks, at least in the last half. The first half, and I said this before, it's the most Star Wars-y movie you could have made at that time. Of like, you got Jabba the Hutt, which people forget now. That was like, you know, you will see Jabba the Hutt.
Yeah,
you will see.
There was some like revisionism though going on, because I remember when the movie came out, everybody loved it, and it actually did make more money than Empire.
It did well, adjusted for inflation. I think it made a little bit less, but yeah,
because you also got to remember with Empire, you know, when that came out, the critics weren't as kind to it. That's why they didn't, you know, it didn't make a lot of money.
They,
you know, in the beginning.
Yeah, well, they viewed it as the middle.
Well, this,
right.
this
of
is the thing.
Something,
this
you know.
Back in the day when movies would play, because that movie played basically in like the boutique theater, in the 70mm theater for like a year and a half, much like the original Star Wars.
And also sequels were still in their infancy back then. And we
81. Not everything 81 was when they would 81 was when they would like have the re-release upon re-release upon re-release, like two or three re-releases before, and then.
But I have a newspaper review of Jedi, and it got 4 stars. I mean, people loved it. Critics loved it.
Oh, Roger Ebert and Gene Siskel, they loved it, and they're
Siskel gave it 3 stars, by the way.
Oh, Siskel gave it 3. Okay, I know Ebert gave it 4.
Yeah, Siskel gave it 3. But I remember Ebert did give it 4. Now, yeah. I don't know if he gave it 4 at the beginning, but I know when he put it on his great movies list.
Oh, no, he did.
But then it becomes a generational thing, because you really enjoy the movie. It's part of a trilogy. It's
my childhood.
It's the end of a story.
And this was, I was 11 when this came out, so the Carrie Fisher in the outfit didn't quite have the effect on me that, say, like 12-year-old me might have had.
I started to get ideas when I saw that. I was like, wait a minute, she's a woman. And
yeah, well, she's too damn, the problem is she's coked out, she's skinny, she's vulnerable.
She's skinny,
like,
but,
that's not my thing.
Well, I don't know, her weight goes up and down in that movie. It's weird. She's really skinny in some shots, and she looks just right in others.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, that's what happens when you're coked out and it takes you 6 months to make a movie. That's what's going to happen. Okay, so that's a number four or five?
That's
number four. Okay, so number five. Okay, so I've got the original trilogy, and I've got Last Jedi in there. I would say the next one is Force Awakens. I'd put it there.
I can accept the positioning where you put it. I can accept that.
Okay, Force Awakens, because it is while it's not perfect and it is a retread, it is fun and it was great, you know. This kind of has to do with like letting go of things and starting new things. Of like, this was a movie that I saw a few months after I had, I mean, look, I am a super nerd, and I'm very sheltered, and I had maybe like a few months before I'd actually just moved out of my parents' house. Mm-hmm. So I was on my own, I'm an adult. I'd moved twice, actually, went in an apartment, and now I'm in a house. I'm in a great neighborhood. I got a new movie theater. Star Wars is coming out. It was like, it was a magical time. And I'm like, I'm going. I'm like, this was great. I saw it in like a premium theater. It was fun. And this was back. This was literally like, things were different literally 3 years ago, where you could actually buy a ticket that day and see it in a theater and actually like have a good seat. Mm, you can't do that now. You actually have to buy your seat ahead of time now.
Well, actually, you know, it's gotten really good around my theater, because if you get in early enough, you can actually reserve your seats and not have to pay extra anymore.
That's what I do. I mean, I just go. I maybe
it's no longer it used, but a couple of years before,
it used to cost extra to get the seat ahead of time.
Yeah, RPX. That was the only way you could reserve seats at my theater once upon a time. Now
every theater is reserved in my, and I have an AMC.
The only time it's not is when 75% of the theater has been sold already. You can't reserve anymore. If you get in early enough, you can reserve seats. So,
well, I walked in, I got a good seat, I went, it was great, I had fun, but I'm like, okay, this is a good start, this is fun. Nothing was really unexpected. I was expecting Han Solo to get killed. And
I wasn't expecting that. That really did shock me.
So then the next one would be, I guess, Rise of Skywalker.
So Rise of Skywalker is the worst of the movies for you.
If I go back and I see it again, or when I get the disc or whatever and I see it again, this might change. But this is my opinion after sitting on it for a while, because initially I might have even put it above Force Awakens just because of the batshit insanity of it. But then the more I think about it, I'm like, you know, this is not 100% competent filmmaking, especially from J.J. Abrams, who should know better.
Well, that's probably because he had to tie up a whole bunch of shit that was left hanging out there.
He had the combination of tie up a loose. First of all, give this movie an extra 20 minutes. Give me some plot. Okay.
There's
3 hours.
That is one of my problems with the movie.
The bar has been raised with Marvel movies. Now, I know you haven't watched them, or you're not super into them. I'm sure Frelick is.
I'll probably get into them this year.
What they were able to do with all of those movies, with all of those like sort of side movies, and then meeting with sort of the meetup movies, was genius. Had foresight and thought was put into things. And they were also allowed to be creative and come up with like little funny jokes that pay off like two movies later and stuff like that. Whereas with this, it was, we got to come up with something. I know that Colin Trevorrow was initially signed to do this movie. This is a guy who made Jurassic World.
Mm.
And he's actually going to make Jurassic World 3 too. And he was brought in. And this is where, you know, Rian Johnson, he was conferring with J.J. Abrams when he was making Force Awakens. And they were like, could you change this one thing so that I can put it in my movie? He's like, sure, I had to do something to do R2-D2 or something. They say that in his plot, in his idea, his story idea, Palpatine wasn't even in it.
Mm, yeah.
And I don't think it was changed because I think it was his idea. Well, he's like, oh, he looked at Rian Johnson movie. He's like, oh, okay, well, here, I don't need Palpatine. And then they said, no, you got to put Palpatine in. And he probably said, no. And then that's probably what it was. I think that his idea might have been better, because having Palpatine come in out of nowhere, when you could have, if you had an original plan to have Palpatine come in, you should have sprinkled stuff in there.
Yeah, that's
a little bit more.
Because but when you put Palpatine in this movie, you have shifted the entire story to place a greater emphasis on his character, because he's a major character in Jedi. He makes a brief appearance in Empire, but he's a major character in the prequels. And then it sort of irritates me a little bit, because he outlives Han, Luke, and Leia.
But does he? I mean, he's sort of evil dead.
Did you notice that he's on some kind of life support? Did you notice that
he looks like that thing in the basement in Evil Dead, in Evil Dead 2.
He's got like IV lines going into him or something that's keeping him alive. I mean,
yeah,
it's not.
You could say
weird.
Cloning. You could say something. He's obviously on the evil Jedi planet with all these hooded figures. Something out of like I'm just thinking like of the black hole.
Well, I was thinking
like,
a little
man,
more
like the black hole ending where he ends up in hell.
I was thinking more of Mordor. It just looked like a place of evil or something.
If you're
gonna
go batch it and say just go full black hole. He's in hell. He's become one with.
But the thing is, I agree with you on this. The movie feels rushed. It had more reason to have a longer running time than any other film in the series, because it's the last
one. They all come in at like 2 hours 20 some, and I've heard rumors that it was like. First it was like 2:45, then it was 2:35, now it's 2:22, and it's like, give me some plot.
I already know exactly who Palpatine looks like. Mm-hmm. Looks like Dr. Chouinard from Hellraiser 2.
Yes!
Dr. Chouinard, Hellraiser 2. Okay. Is that the guy who was like, I suggest radical reconstruction surgery.
Yes.
The doctor is in. I was watching the Red Letter Media review of it, and they said that the movie felt like several truncated episodes of a TV series rather than just one whole cohesive movie.
Do you remember when they did a prediction of what might happen, and their idea was even more batshit insane?
Yeah.
It'd be time travel. But there was this one reviewer, her name is, I think, Jenny Nicholson.
Yes, I have a clip.
Did you see her review where she basically made like this sort of like Star Wars bingo cards of like batshit insane ideas, and if you just pick, and she made all these batshit insane ideas on her card to like stamp, and almost all the things that she came up with just pulled out of her ass actually happened in the movie, and I'm like, yeah, it's like this was. This was like, we got to come up with something. We have a release date. Fuck it.
Fuck it.
Here you go, JJ.
I think they might have had the plan, and then they listened to the feedback, and they didn't. Well, you know, they didn't stick to their guns.
They should have taken the track that Last Jedi was. Maybe make a few tweaks to for fan service. Lando was in it, and I felt bad because if you really look at like. Look at
Billy D.
He's
not in the best shape. He really doesn't move around all
but
that
much.
But
you know what? He's there. They fixed his hair. He's kind of got hair now. But he's basically kind of like leaning up against things or sitting down because he's just he's in. I think he's in his 80s now. I mean, but
yeah, he's like 80. I think he is 80.
But you know what? It's okay. This man probably got the most amount, the best quality amount of many women in his life. This man has loved. Like no man has loved before.
He probably broke his hip a few times, yeah.
He probably broke his penis a couple times. This man, he was
works
a
every time.
Man. He had his Colt 45, and that's all he needed, man. He was getting it, so he's a life well lived. So he's okay, and I'm sure he's happy with what he's done and how he's lived his life. So good for him. And I love that he wore that same outfit that in Solo. Like he had that yellow, whatever that yellow thing was. This is, again... And I don't hate this movie, but it's below that. Okay, so now we're getting into the dredges. I think it goes Phantom Menace. Oh wait.
Yippee.
I didn't get into the side stories. I put Rogue One right below it. It's probably higher on my list than it would have been because I rewatched it. I'm like, this doesn't completely suck. This is okay. This is not and I would literally tie it with Solo because again. I imagine what Solo could have been, like the Lord and Miller version of this movie, might have been just what Star Wars needed. It might have been like this batshit insane, fun.
They sort of, you know, I
zippy dialogue. Now, I felt bad. Ron Howard, he needs a hit. And this is not the hit he got because it was a flop.
Oh, it's probably the most profitable movie he's ever made. If that's any consolation.
Hell, a Willow was more profitable than this.
Really?
Because Willow only cost him 30-some million, and it probably made like 100 million worldwide, and then it had video and everything. That probably made more money than
Willow
this.
Willow is one of those movies I like to forget. I don't know why.
Yeah.
The one thing that disappointed me about Solo, because I did enjoy the movie, is that they kind of turned him into a buffoon there. He was supposed to have been like a really good pilot or something like that, but he gets lucky at the end in the Kessel Run sequence, and I feel that they
that actor he got, but I will say the actor Alden Ehrenreich, he got it down. I think they need to do something with his hair.
I feel like
we can't
do this dashing rogue anymore. We can't do Harrison Ford anymore. You know,
he did good, and I think that when they have those spin-off shows, when they have. They're probably going to do some sort of spin-off series that incorporates all of the different timelines of Star Wars. You're going to have your Obi-Wan Kenobi show, and you're going to have like maybe somehow he's going to be Han Solo again in something, I think.
Hmm.
And it'd probably be a much better showcase for his performance of what he was trying to do. And it'd be a much more thought out thing. Hell, he could show up in, he can't show up in that. They'll figure something out. They'll do something. So I would put those tied, basically, because they're equally good for different reasons. Solo is more sort of acceptable, whereas Rogue One has a lot more issues. The ending is so awesome that it bumps it up. There's that, and now we're getting into the prequels. Is seven? Let's see.
Oh, we all know how this is gonna go. Forget
it's gonna go Phantom Menace, Attack of the Clones, or Phantom Menace. No, wait. Revenge of the Sith, Phantom Menace, Attack of the Clones.
There we go.
Bing, bang, boom.
Bing, bang, boom. That's
you know, our lists are a little bit off here.
Yes.
It's weird.
We all agree on what number one and the last one should be.
Yeah, that's weird, isn't it? We agree that Empire's the best, Attack of the Clones is the worst.
Thank you.
thing
and
is
they're both
the
second movies in each series.
You can put Attack of the Clones on and you know, you won't lose your erection. You know, it's not gonna kill you. It's not gonna hurt you.
I'm racking my brain trying to figure out what if there was any good quality to Attack of the Clones that I could remember.
Yoda, I mean, a lot of people say Yoda using a lightsaber.
Yoda, yes, he does the whole.
A lot of people try to say that him using a lightsaber is freaking sacrilege, fighting freaking Darth Tyrannus. But
you
have
to.
What?
This is the weapon of a Jedi Knight.
You got Christopher Lee. You got the little ending, the little tag with his plans for the Death Star that was like a last minute addition. I'm like, okay, all right. There's like a couple of good things in there.
I mean, it had some good moments, but at the end of the day, it was the first hour of that movie is fucking boring.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That movie is just like, okay, the best story.
Oh, the launch. The launch of the Empire of those Star Destroyers. The launch is always a big moment for me when in.
That's the end of the movie though. The best story I could tell about this. I mean, this is my own mother when she watched them with me. My mom wanted to watch the prequel trilogy back in 2007. She loved Phantom Menace because my mom, you know, she's older, she doesn't know. When we watched Attack of the Clones, she watched 30 minutes of it and she goes, John, this movie's boring. Can you just tell me how it ends so we can go to Revenge of the Sith? I'm like, I'm like, thank you. I'm like, thank
well,
you.
Another main problem for me with Clones is that it's an unpleasant movie to look at. When we saw it in the theater, it looked like shit in the theater. Then we looked at it on DVD.
First movie shot. He basically shot it with like one Sony like HD camera.
Yeah, the Sony Cine Alta, which was in its infancy at the time.
And I will say on Disney Plus, they kind of cleaned it up.
Well, no, I'll say the DVD again. The DVD looked like crap, and then I got the Blu-ray set, and it does look a little better. At least you can make it out. It was really murky. That DVD was incredibly murky, and even the projection of it in the theater was really murky. And I think it was a film projection.
Shot at 24 frames, and it's not one of those things where it's like shot. It's not like one of those Hobbit things where it's shot at 48 and it looks like soap opera effect, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Well,
we gotta get to the movie.
Regarding Anderson's list, let me just say one thing. Yeah. My friend, who's kind enough to let me use his computer right now, made the best point ever. He said, any Star Wars movie that doesn't have the Millennium Falcon sucks.
Ah.
Okay, let's think about that. Empire, good. Force Awakens, good. Star Wars, good. Rogue One didn't have a Millennium Falcon.
I mean, we're basing this off Anderson's list here. So I mean, Rogue One's the odd man out on this one,
Rise
but we're basing it off Anderson's.
And who's to say in Rogue One there wasn't? Because there's the Millennium Falcon, but you could say you could do it like a side. You could cheat and say like one of those, because they're basically like courier ships or something. Maybe they snuck one of those in.
I want to get to my points about Rise of Skywalker here. Now we started off, the crawl already kind of reveals in spoiler form that Palpatine is alive. You know, it says Palpatine is alive, you know, and there's a threat of revenge. And even though it's never really explained, there are too many unexplained revelations in the Rise of Skywalker. Palpatine strapped to a chair, life support gadgets connected to him. He doesn't look terrible, I got to say. Now, we get into Princess Leia, and she, again, as in Last Jedi, she demonstrates previously unknown traits, and we get a kind of an explanation that Luke started training her shortly after the destruction of the second Death Star, and then we get that kind of awkward visual effect, which I'm really hoping they'll clean up for the Blu-ray.
Yeah, I heard that they actually took those shots from Return of the Jedi. Like that's what it looked like. They said that they took a shot from Return of the Jedi, took like an outtake from Return of the Jedi and rotoscoped it in. It like, doesn't look right. I hope they fix it. But everything in this movie is last minute.
She's got this look on her face like she's still processing or something. But yeah. I felt that they got Hamill down. They seem to get the men better.
I'd have to look again.
Maybe I spend too much time looking at women.
I'm glad that they threw that explanation in there about, you know, Leia being a Jedi Master or something like that, because, you know, it's never alluded to in Force Awakens or Last Jedi. But
yeah, they kind of cover Rian Johnson's butt there, don't they?
Because that's JJ cleaning up Rian's mess, because, you know, who the fuck else is supposed to train Rey?
I always wonder, like, okay, she stopped her training because she saw her son die. And this is before she even had her son.
Yeah.
But then you can explain that we're saying Luke is helping her harness her force powers, and you know, a Jedi can see into the future according, you know, this is Yoda from Empire Strikes Back saying, you know, if you search deep, you can see your future, or you can see the future.
Or it could just be another bid to be woke by making women stronger than men. Just going to throw that one out there.
Sometimes they are.
We've moved on. It's almost like we've almost forgotten that there was a handful of people in the Millennium Falcon at the end of Last Jedi, because we've got an assembled, we're assembling the resistance again.
And oh, no, but wait a minute. This movie starts in sort of a, you need a montage.
Montage.
Where Kylo Ren is getting, you know, he's got the triangle. You know, he's got like this.
We're on a mission, and we're looking for these objects, right?
He has the triangle so he can find, and he has to go to Moose. Now, by the way, they don't explain what planets he's on when he's doing this.
Oh, no, it is Mustafar, though.
It is, but they don't say it is.
Is it Mustafar? I mean, did they say?
He's on Mustafar.
Wait, it actually looks like Mustafar too, right?
It looked like he was in the woods to me. He didn't look like he was on lava and like a lava planet with like a building or anything.
Oh, so okay, all right.
And then he's got his wayfinder, so he finds the secret planet. I guess everything is within warp capability, as everything is close. He goes to the planet.
Yeah, and nobody's worrying about fuel this time. Everybody was worried about fuel in Last Jedi.
He meets Palpatine, and this is what I like about the movie. It gets right to a point. It's like, okay, Palpatine, he's alive, and here he is, and here's what he did. And he's like, you know, and he talked about, I killed Snoke, of like, I made Snoke. And then there's like, they pan over, and he's in like a jar. There's like a jar of other Snokes, and I'm like, all right, I see. If like, it's a fuck you. It's a fuck you.
I would not mind a director's cut with added scenes, because I felt like Palpatine was shoehorned a little too hard into this one.
Yeah, you know, that's JJ cleaning up Rian Johnson's mess again.
What if we did this? What if we had George Lucas come back and we had him do a complete re-edit of all three of them he could sprinkle stuff in?
Into one movie. You know? This is the first opportunity, this movie. But we get to see Rey, Finn, and Poe working together as a group. That's the problem with Rise of Skywalker for me. Is only the problem that it had trying to, number one, clean up the mess of Last Jedi, which kind of leaves everything out in the open and makes it look like failure is imminent. But for me, Last Jedi really wasted opportunities by not showing them working together. It should have had them doing that. In the third movie, you might be able to buy a little bit more of the kind of crazy shit that was going on in Last Jedi. But in the second movie, we need to establish relationships here. And the only relationships that we had were Rey and Finn. Poe is there. Poe knows Finn, but Poe does not know Rey. And consequently, Finn, and Rey are not a team.
We have Carrie Fisher in his sort of weird... I was thinking about this. If anybody's watched Sopranos, about how the guy that played Tony Soprano's mom, she died, and they had to have like an episode where they like have her like say something to Tony, and then you find out she died like later in the episode. And then, of course, they can write like him being affected by it. But they took like scenes, other stuff, and they sort of digitally put her in, and it fits so poorly. If you ever can, maybe I'll find the clip.
Well,
where
yeah,
like she kind of well, she goes, meh,
all
Tony.
Of her. Well, I mean, like all of Leia's like dialogue is inconsequential. It's like
yeah,
a
it's
bunch
like,
of like
reaction.
It's a bunch of like words strung together that kind
yes,
of make
it's
no
like
sense.
A lot of yeses and nos and like.
And she's
look
and she's
and,
like sometimes I guess they use a body double and they put her in shadow.
But I will say this. It's like, and this is J.J. Abrams, he said this, he's like, if you didn't know, you wouldn't know. You would think, oh, they just kind of gave her, they kind of did a...
Well, yeah, well, instead it would be the three of us going, wow, what was with Carrie Fisher in that movie? She seemed like she wasn't there.
Yeah, she seemed like a little like, they gave her, like, they cut all of her part out.
We might not have never had any indication that she died, but she did die, and we know this, and we're going into the movie knowing it.
Yeah.
And that was one of the times.
But considering what they had, they did a good job with it. I put it that way.
Well, yeah. A person died. You can't
like
bring them back.
They,
you know,
I just realized they kind of did a Peter Sellers in Casino Royale situation where it's like they'd fired him halfway through because he was mentally ill. And so there's, oh, fuck it. We'll just blow him up.
This was one of the moments where I shed some tears. I started crying in this movie, and I must have cried maybe three times. And my daughter was looking over at me because she heard me going, like
cue
that.
The clip from The Crying Wife.
So we just got done watching Return of the Jedi. All he cries at everything. Watch. Are you going to be okay?
Did R2-D2 get put back together?
Does R2-D... Yeah, R2-D2 gets put back together.
But I didn't see him get put back together.
He was at the very end of the movie. Him and C-3PO were together.
I'll refer to you, Kevin Smith. Kevin Smith's review. He started crying. He cried twice in his review of Rise of Skywalker.
And then he calls. He says, "Dad," to Han Solo, because he was always calling him like Han Solo in the movies, right? And he goes, "Dad, And then Han Solo goes, I know. Come on, man. Like, you can shit on this movie all you want, but, like, that's fan service beautiful right there. That's Han Solo's I love you. He said it to Ben's mother when she's like, I love you. He goes, I know. So when he goes, Dad, and he goes, I know. That was him telling his son he loved him. That's way better than if Harrison Ford had said, I love you, like in the dialogue. I thought that was beautiful, man. Really, obviously beautiful to me. Sorry. Getting over a cold.
I did not cry once in this movie.
I cried when Leia died, and she was clutching the medal that she gave Han Solo at the end of New Hope.
That was the only part I shed a tear at, by the way.
This is why I might be like losing my nerd cred, because like at the very end when you know they take that medal and they give it to Chewie, you know?
Yeah.
What the fuck is that? I'm like, I thought in my head, like, what was that thing? So I didn't realize till after, oh, it was the medal. Like, I had to see a review of like, oh shit, I didn't even remember that it was the medal that he was supposed to get. And I'm like, geez, I think I'm an old man now. I don't care.
Yeah, strange. In the novelization of Star Wars, Chewie did get his medal. It's just Chewie had to lower his head really down to the ground to get her for her to be able to put it on him. Okay, so that was the first
one thing of like. At least in this particular instance, it wasn't one of those things where you have to read like a side book or read the novelization to get to understand of like, that's the thing I don't like about Star Wars is it's like, oh, if you want to know more, this turns into like it's turning into the episode of like an end of an episode of like Voyagers. Like, if you want to know more, go to your local library. Well, I'm like, fuck you.
Well, there's a lot
don't
of.
Don't make me have to read a goddamn book.
There were Timothy Zahn's series that he wrote.
Yes.
That follows after the events of Jedi was very well written. It was a very good continuation of the story.
I started it on book on cassette, but I got like 20 minutes in and got distracted.
She is clutching this medal and kind of summoning a quote unquote force ghost of Han Solo. Han Solo appears before Kylo, and they kind of have a mirror discussion of what they said right before Kylo killed him in the first movie. That now, it was so nice. That this was wonderful, and now we're going to talk about all the good things. Let's talk about the good things, shall we? And we'll put up a picture of a kitten, for effect.
I want to say this though, the force power that Leia used to sort of distract Kylo Ren at the end, and then that healing power that that Rey used, you know, that was pre. And maybe Freylich understands this because he probably rewatched Mandalorian. The baby Yoda used that healing power on the episode of the Mandalorian that dropped early on a
Wednesday. Oh, well, the healing
on a Friday. Baby Yoda used the healing power on an episode that came out on Wednesday before, because they usually drop them on Friday, but they did this 2 days early.
I had not seen that, but I already knew.
Have you seen that, Mr.
Freylich? I only saw the first episode. Oh, yeah. That healing thing did not surprise me because Palpatine, in his efforts to seduce Anakin to the dark side, said they could heal people with their powers. Yeah. So
I find unnatural.
It's there. I mean, it's there. Lucas created that. So it's right there.
Because Darth Plagueis was the one that could, you know, manipulate the midichlorians into creating or killing people, basically.
Yeah, all the Scientology stuff.
You could almost say that in a weird way that this is spoiler, but Rey is like Palpatine's granddaughter, which I didn't understand was the fact that. Okay, but
that's another fuck you to Rian Johnson.
If she's her granddaughter,
that is a fuck you to Rian Johnson.
If she's his granddaughter, then that means he had a son or a daughter. He had a son. Okay, that was his son. Why didn't his son have any powers?
Because maybe here's the thing. Okay, there's an easy explanation. Rey didn't even know she was force sensitive until she was called upon. Rey had no idea she was force sensitive until Force Awakens. She had no idea. Maybe his son never. You know, here's what you got.
But he would have used his son as a backup. He would have used his son as a base. Like, okay, if things are going to shit, I'm going into my son.
Right, but at the same time, you know, Palpatine probably, you know, yeah, he could have used his son, but I think he wanted the girl more. I think maybe he knew his son wasn't force sensitive. But dude, it's a plot hole. It's a fucking plot.
Well, there is also the other thing. You know, because they're Sith, they're evil. Darth Vader, a la Anakin, aka Anakin Skywalker, knew damn well who Owen and Beru were. He knew them, and he had them murdered. why not Palpatine have his own children murdered? If they didn't want to embrace the dark side or be a part of it or fought him actively, there are plenty of different explanations.
Now that's a good way of putting it. Maybe his son renounced him, says, I'm not going to have any part of this. He kept his force sensitivity hidden, and he's like, give me my granddaughter because I know she's force sensitive because it's in blood.
Yeah.
And then just snatched her, you know, snatched, well, not snatched.
There's something
her,
there. These people, you know, these are bad guys. These are bad guys. They're evil, you know?
But then we talk about the whole fuck you to Rian Johnson. Last Jedi sets it up to where, hey, anyone can be force sensitive. Hey, Rey, your parents were fucking nobodies.
That's what Kylo kept telling her. It kept getting on my nerves too, because Kylo Ren kept saying, "Did he ever tell you about your parents? Did he ever tell you about your parents?"
That's the Obi-Wan certain point of view kind of bullshit, you know.
Now I wanted to mention the other time. Now, when Harrison Ford appears and they have their discussion, I started crying again. It was wonderful to see. I did not know about that. That was one thing.
Because I hear, hey, kid, and I'm like, oh, because his last line was, see you around, kid.
Well, he said he was not going to come back. He's in half retirement, semi-retirement. And he sort of walked on. He walked on and did this thing.
This might have been a favor. Please come back.
Okay.
You know he made the most money out of anybody. Who made Rise of Skywalker?
He did. But he was uncredited. He was uncredited in the movie too. Carrie Fisher gets top billing.
Like in the credits at the end credits of like Daisy Ridley, who does carry this movie quite well.
She actually does.
She's like third, fourth billing. It's like
she's all the way down there.
It's
yeah.
Like Mark. It's Mark Hamill. Then it's Carrie Fisher. Then it's more established actors. The Poe guy, Oscar Isaac. Then her. Then
John Boyega.
It's like, man, and she carries this movie.
Okay,
she's
and
good.
My favorite moment in the movie is the one that again had me crying, and that was when Rey was dying from all the horrible lightning bolts, and then suddenly she starts hearing the voices of Jedi, and they are all the voices. They even got an audio clip of Alec Guinness, and threw it in there. I heard Alec Guinness. First thing I knew, I heard was Samuel L. Jackson. I was like. He was like, get up, motherfucker!
That's what I want to hear is get up, motherfucker.
Yeah. And then you hear Liam Neeson, and you hear Ewan McGregor, and you even hear Ahsoka Tano, who was my favorite character in the Clone Wars. I love Ahsoka Tano. They got the girl who did her voice on that show to do a... It was... Oh, God, it was one beautiful.
Was in there. I didn't notice that, but I heard that later. But this was something that I was hoping would happen, and it seemed like they sort of half-assed it, where I'm like, if they all show up as, like, force ghosts, if all the old people come in, and Liam Neeson, you know, you give him money, he'll do anything. and it's like, if they can get all the people back, do a little CG if they have to, bring all the Jedi back that you've known over the years, they all have force ghosts, and then they use, like, their final... last gasp of their Jedi energy or something. That would have been awesome. They kind of half-assed it.
Well, I don't know if I would have preferred seeing them as Force ghosts. I would have, because what would they have been doing? They were just standing up over her like Mickey from Rocky saying, come on, get up. You're going to eat lightning and crap thunder.
You got to get up.
You're a rocking machine. You know, I like hearing the voices. The voices were fine. They were good enough for me.
I was perfectly fine with that. It didn't bother me in the least. That was actually one of the most redeeming parts of the ending right there. Oh, and by the way, speaking of the ending, okay, a lot of people are fucking butthurt about how Rey pretty much took down Palpatine with the lightsabers, right? Mm-hmm. I'm like, dude, only one Jedi was capable of destroying Palpatine with, you know, reharnessing Force Lightning back, and that was fucking Mace Windu.
That's right. He
got distracted. Fucking Anakin fucking did what he did. That's another...
Yeah.
Dude, point is, if Anakin hadn't been in that room, Mace Windu would have fucked his shit up.
Probably,
Can I just say, like, I just realized, like, you know what would have been the perfect ending? It would fit in with the batshit insanity of it. I don't know if you remember the movie Krull. And how at the end it was basically the power of love ending, where they used they were getting married and they had the power that I give fire to water or something, and then the fire comes out of their hands and it kills the beast thing. I was thinking, man, this would be like the perfect opportunity. You get Kylo and you get Reylo together, and then like the force lightning come out of both their hands, and then they could kill him. That would have been awesome.
You bring up Krull, because I was looking. Okay, you remember Rogue One, the actress that they hired to composite Carrie Fisher. Now the girl that they hired to play Carrie Fisher's stand-in and put Carrie Fisher's face over her. If you look at pictures of her, without all of that, just what she looks like. She looks almost exactly like Lizette Anthony in Kroll. It's very interesting. It's interesting. Look it up. Look it up. You'll see her face.
I will look that up.
She looks so much like Lizette Anthony in that movie.
By the way, audience, if you have not seen the movie Kroll, find the movie Kroll and experience it. Get the cheap Blu-ray. Get the special edition DVD if you can with all the special features. It's an awesome movie. It's completely batshit insane and it's stupid, but the score on it is awesome. It's probably James Horner's best score. Okay.
Oh, and for all you Star Trek nerds, that's Eddington from Deep Space Nine playing Ken Marshall in Kroll.
Yes.
Except he's missing a lot of hair. But otherwise,
and you know what? He's at least he's still alive. He's part of that sort of that class of like Chris Reeve and Robin Williams, and he's the only one that survives. So he's probably like hiding right now. It is what it is, and that's okay. We get to have what we want. I mean, it kind of ends. This is okay. I want to sort of mention the ending real quick. Okay, so basically to wrap up,
Ewoks.
Babu Frick.
Yeah, Babu Frick. Rey somehow like. It's this weird sort of like, I have the power, I'm going to give you the power, where it's like, first she heals Kylo Ren, who becomes Ben again.
Oh God. Yeah.
And she,
kisses him
but that's at the very end.
Of tongues here.
She, Rey uses her force power to heal him first, but that doesn't kill her or anything. But then she leaves and he's there and he's alive. And then he has the conversation with, sort of his memory of Han Solo, if I'm not mistaken. Okay. Then they have that moment. Then at the very end, when Knights of Ren, by the way, completely underutilized, and it's like, why even have them?
Right. Yes, I know. Yeah.
Kind of like,
another wasted premise.
That was a wasted. I mean, twice wasted. They kind of have them for like 2 seconds, and they keep like promoting them, like the Knights of Ren. I'm like, they're just a bunch of guys.
Just
in
like
helmets.
What's her name, Captain Phasma.
See, that was another thing of like.
Like the Darth Maul, they're the Darth Maul Boba Fett type characters.
It would have been great to have Captain Phasma show up again. He's like, what the hell?
Yeah.
Might as well. I think it would have
been. They should have shown her. I mean, I don't know why they didn't have a hand rising up from something and going, I will kill you, Finn.
And then at the very end, you have. She uses the. And then at the very end, so he vanquishes Knights of Ren in a very silly way. In a very rushed way.
Yeah.
Then they have the final battle with Palpatine on his sort of Duck Chouinard thing. And she uses the power of the Force with all of the Jedi, and he has all of the Sith. Why didn't he use the power of any of all of the Sith? I am the Jedi, or something like
Maybe
that.
Maybe it just comes down to something as simple as good will triumph over evil.
Yeah, well, the problem is, we live in the real world. It never does.
I mean, the thing about it is, if Palpatine is seducing Anakin with the idea of being able to heal people and bring them back from death, this doesn't sound like something Sith types would exploit. It sounds like something the good would do, you know? The good would heal. The Sith would destroy. That's how I see it.
She's dead. She's used all of her Force power, but she's kind of dead. And you can kind of tell she's dead because she's like all like gray and... They kind of like, she's like, all of her power is just gone.
Hmm.
So Kylo Ren comes over and he uses his force power to heal her, and he uses all of his life force. Okay.
Yeah.
Then she kisses him. I think that's what happens. Like, she kisses him and then he dies.
She kisses, well, I mean, no, he's healed. He's like a new man. He looks like a brand new boy, and he's looking at her with different eyes. Actually, you know, Adam Driver, we don't talk about him. Great actor. He does a fine job.
Oh, he is.
He's wonderful.
You watch the show, the movie Marriage Story. He's really good in that.
I am going to look at that because I understand.
That's really good. But I will say
he's in it with Laura Dern, of all people.
It's basically to scare you off of never get married, because you'll watch that and you go, oh, fuck. And I thought everything was fine.
Well, I mean, he's a fine actor because I saw him in two movies last year. I saw him in The Man Who Killed Don Quixote, and I saw him in this. So it was actually an Adam Driver year for us. But he's able to he does the tortured, conflicted stuff a hell of a lot better than Hayden did in the prequels.
Yes,
and I felt that was probably it was down to Lucas. I think Hayden could have done
it. Okay, so she kisses him, and I think it's an earned kiss because it's like she can't not, because
it looks real. I mean, you're kind of you're definitely with him, but it shocked me. It shocked me, and it disgusted Regan, and it amused my wife.
You can say they're almost related when you think about it, because if he's technically he is a Skywalker. Okay.
Think about it like the Montagues and the Capulets from Romeo and Juliet.
Anakin was created, we'll say, by Darth Plagueis, which is him, or Darth. We can assume that Darth Sidious Palpatine created him through the Force. He is the Anakin was created by the Emperor, and he used his DNA. Maybe he did like the twins.
Well,
he,
Vader, yeah. Vader, it's yes, Vader.
He created him in some way. Okay,
right. So, Anakin is not Vader. Anakin is separate. Vader is something else. Vader is the construction. Is
from a certain point of view.
Vader is the creation of the Emperor. Anakin was something. Anakin was the little boy. The little boy who hugged his mom.
But anyway, I want to get to my point.
Okay.
So she kisses him, which I think was earned. You could say like, oh, there shouldn't have been a romantic, you know, but then it's like this weird thing where it's like they had their cake and ate it too, where it's like he was redeemed. He was redeemed, but he had to die as well. So it's like, I think that they played that as well as you could play it, however you were going to do it. But then, okay, so he died, it was fine. Then when he dies, he does like the Jedi thing where he becomes one with the Force. Okay, now that's fine. That's fine. You're following your own Star Wars rules. That's fine. At the end, when Rey goes back to bury the lightsabers, which makes no fucking sense, on Tatooine, which makes no fucking sense. Nice to see the set. And the set was shot at the same angles where you saw Luke drinking the green milk and everything.
Plus, they didn't pull any punches. They didn't cheap out. They actually built that set.
She buries them. That's I.
The ground
no
sucks them up.
She
actually, she okay. just puts then them down, and then the ground goes and just sucks it in.
Yeah, she has her lightsaber, which I found out like later is kind of the end of her staff. Like it's the end of her staff, and she made her own lightsaber. It's the end of that walking staff.
Yes,
thing that she
yes.
had. Then the lightsaber comes out. It's a yellow lightsaber. Now, you could say what it references. To me, it references the original Luke Skywalker action figure that had the yellow lightsaber. That's what it signifies to me. It might signify something else to somebody else. It might be a reference to something else. But to me, it was like, oh, it's a yellow lightsaber, like the Luke Skywalker action figure had that had nothing to do with the movie.
So you think it was like a wink and a nudge?
Yeah. So she sees the Force ghosts, which I am also completely okay with, of Luke and Leia. That's fine.
Yeah.
I think they should have gone Return of the Jedi, where first you see Luke and Leia, then there's like a pause, and then Kylo Ren comes up, or Ben Solo comes up. I think that they should have had Ben Solo as a Force ghost at the end, because he was technically redeemed, much like Anakin Skywalker in various versions of Return of the Jedi, where you see either, I think, Sebastian Shaw,
he was the original.
Sebastian Shaw or Hayden Christensen.
And they put freaking Hayden in there too, yeah.
Okay.
It's consistent. It's in keeping with the Lucas's story.
He was redeemed. He should have popped up. He should have been a surprise. Should have been like a good long pause where you're like, oh, and then he pops up. And it's like, oh, because he didn't do anything worse than what Darth Vader did. He probably did less.
Yeah, okay, I've always had a problem with that. It's very Catholic. It's very much this idea of you can commit the worst sins in the world as long as you renounce at the end, then you get to party with Yoda and Obi-Wan. I never really liked that, but it is in keeping with
he should have popped up. Lucas that would thing. Have been more in keeping with what they did originally. I would say overall my I had a whole situation when I went to this movie. It was a complicated situation. I had the tickets. I had good seats in the IMAX 3D. It just sort of turned out that a theater, I think I told you this, the IMAX 3D theater in my local area was under construction when the tickets first went on sale. Okay. They were fixing it, renovating it. So all those advanced tickets went on sale. And then about a couple weeks later, the theater reopened quietly and nobody had bought up those seats yet. And I was like, oh shit. So I got good seats before people noticed. And so I got good seats, but then through a series of situations with my roommate and his car, I had to do a whole thing where I had to drive him to a service place to pick up his car and then go to the movie. And this was, we were having like the rainstorm of the century, like the last 2 days of like, it was like a Thursday and Friday. So I'm right in puddles. This is Snohomish County, home of the ditch.
Mm-hmm.
Everything is puddles and ditches, like all the way over there. And I got to go all the way one end of town and go all the way back to the movie theater. Somehow I made it in. I sat down. I watched the movie. So I was already frazzled watching this movie. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to sit down. I'm going to watch this movie. I'm going to get on with my life. And I can put this behind me. So it was very much like, I just want this to be done now. So I watched it and I'm like, okay, I'm not pissed. I'm not angry. I'm somewhat underwhelmed, but I am also a grown adult. I have a very full life. This is nice, and Star Wars is going to keep going. You know, a long-term contract I had to sign, since I'll be making these movies to the end of time with my Yoda.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so I am okay. We're fine. I'm fine. We're all fine. How are you?
We're sending a squad up.
Yeah.
I couldn't think of a better way to end it except to say that, okay, when I got out of Last Jedi, I was angry. I was really upset and I left. I didn't even know that I wanted to see this movie when it was announced. I decided to do it because I wanted to do a show with you guys, too. We usually make it a tradition. I didn't make it a tradition this year for various reasons to watch all the movies around Christmas time. Now we're going to be up to 11 by next Christmas. So it's going to be an 11-movie marathon. At the end of this movie, when the credits rolled, I applauded. And then finally, other people joined me. No one was going to applaud. They were like, I don't know whether or not I should applaud. I just started. I applauded. And so everyone else was going, okay, he's applauding. Okay, we'll all applaud. So I got the entire theater to applaud. I'm proud of myself for doing that. So.
Yeah, one person applauded when I went. It was like, I had a very sort of polite audience. Mm. I was the one reacting most to stuff when Wedge showed up.
Wedge!
I saw him for like 2 seconds. So you only see him for like a second.
And I said in the theater, I was like, Wedge!
I just went, before I could even like point to the screen, he was gone.
Yeah, he did get a nice little close-up though.
It would have been nice if he said, look at the size of that thing, or something to sort
got
of...
Got the chatter read too.
Yeah, something like that.
All right. Okay, that's this is the end of it. This is the end of it until
this
I guess.
Yeah.
I don't know what's going to happen if we're going to get another trilogy in 10 years or 15 years. I don't know.
Okay, here's what we're going to get. Here's what we know. This is Rumor Control, head of the facts. Here's what we're going to get. We're going to get more Mandalorian. We're going to get an Obi-Wan Kenobi series that Ewan McGregor knew about for 4 years and couldn't say anything and was actually just blatantly lying, saying, I don't know anything about anything. We're going to get it. We were going to get an Obi-Wan Kenobi movie, but I think things are changing now. Things are becoming like more sort of series-based, which is good because you get more character development.
Yeah, I guess.
We're going to get Star Wars is going to change. And that's fine. We're going to get more serious.
Well, I mean, it's okay if you want to go off and create original characters inside this trilogy. If you want to do that, that's fine. That's fine.
Mm-hmm. I think that it's going to actually create more of an event situation where you're going to have the series that's going to be more sort of character oriented. And then you're going to have like these special movies that come out. Make it every 3 years. Stop doing these every 2 year movies. Or every year and a half movies.
Good idea. I agree.
You can't do it. You need at least three. Stretch them out. Get the demand going. Make it a big event. Make it what Star Wars used to be, which was an event. You know, you do them every, even like we had so much, even we had Force Awakens. A year later, we had Rogue One. Then we had The Last Jedi.
Yeah, we've had a new movie every year for 5 years.
6 months later, we got Solo, which was... They were so stupid to release that thing and try and get it done by May. They should have given that like
Christmas,
another 6 months.
Maybe Christmas.
Christmas. Star Wars is Christmas
right.
Now.
No matter what. I mean, like, we have our top 10 lists. We have our best to worst. Our best to worst, there's nothing we can do about changing anything because it's part of this word that they keep using, that Disney keeps using now, which is really annoying, which is saga. So you have 11 movies so far. And I don't know if it's going to end. Maybe we'll have some ruminations on that.
The Skywalker saga is not. The Star Wars saga is whatever it is, and like, you know.
But it's sort of like the Bible, or it's sort of like a sacred series of books, like Chronicles of Narnia, Lord of the Rings, something like that, Harry fucking Potter, whatever it is. And if it's something that brought something out of you, that you grew up and you watched these movies like we did,
yeah.
These movies are my life. I mean, I think I'm going to start crying in a second now.
Yeah.
These movies...
They got you through some tough times, man.
Everything about what these movies were, even in their imperfections, were still part of something perfect. So it was part of like this perfect thing with its imperfections. And that's kind of like what life is. Life has its little moments of perfection, but it also has its moments of imperfection. And Jesus Christ, did I do this? Why did I do that? I can't believe I did this. But other things happened. And that was, I mean, like, we can look back at Jedi maybe as adults and say, yeah, a lot of that was stupid, but God damn it. I mean, like, part of that movie is part of our childhood. So our childhood is inside those movies, every single one of them. They watched those movies watched us grow up, and we grew up with them.
those. I have great memories, especially if it's like seeing Return of the Jedi. I somehow like got off school early. I got like a note from my mom to go see it. And it's like, this is how important Star Wars was. You could get a note from your mom and say, can you please excuse David so we can go see Return of the Jedi at the 3:15 show and leave 15 minutes early.
Jedi,
and somehow I got out.
Jedi was a movie that, I mean, like we had nothing to do in the summertime. So we said, okay, let's go to the movies and see Jedi again. And we would see it like every day.
There was no internet. There was nothing. There was literally nothing. You could go to the movies and that was it.
It was just, and you watch all these people and they grow and they were young. And they were beautiful.
Can I sum it up in one way? When I think of Star Wars, especially the original trilogy, I think of my mother and my father taking me to see them.
That was yeah, you know.
Because here's the thing. I think of mom and dad with the original trilogy. I saw the prequels and the new ones by myself. Well, I'm not by myself, but my parents weren't there. You know, that's the definition of growing up with these movies, because I grew up with them, with my mother and my father, you know, getting them for me on VHS, you know, repeated airings on TV, and then culminating with them taking me to see the trilogy, the special edition trilogy, in theaters back in 1997, 98, you know. But then, when the prequels came out, I had a car, I had a license, you know, that was like, hey, guess what, mom and dad, you can't go see the prequel trilogy with me, but, you know, hey, at least they raised me the right way. You know,
yeah.
It's a family. It's and,
well, I, they, yeah.
movies, in a sense, meaning I grew up with the movies and the movies grew up with me.
And now you can share them with your kids.
God willing.
Regan isn't all that.
I keep saying my kids, they're not my children. Like, me and my wife are the two biggest Star Wars fans, and I have three non-Star Wars fans in my house.
Yeah, Regan doesn't get nearly as excited as I do. I mean, it's sort of sad in a way. I mean, like, I want to wrap this up with my crazy insane theory that I never got to say.
Okay.
My crazy conspiracy theory about Star Wars. And this goes back to George Lucas, and he can roll his eyes if he wants. Star Wars exists as an analogy for the Revolutionary War. It's the Brits versus the Americans. The rebellion is America. The Brits are the Galactic Empire. Wedge Antilles appears in The Rise of Skywalker. Wedge is played by British actor Dennis Lawson, but Lawson is using an American accent. Jyn Erso is British, but because her father, Galen, was a scientist working for the Empire. Unfortunately, Daisy Ridley throws my theory out of whack, but it's possible she was neutral. Yet John Boyega is a British actor, also using an American accent. Thank you, everyone, for listening to this. Thank you, David Anderson. Thank you, John Fralick. It's been swell. And I hope that we continue to watch, review, and complain about Star Wars well into our senior years. And may the Force be with you and all that.
May the Force be with you too, sir.
Good night.
Goodbye.
Bye.